and welcome to Insight Ophthalmology. This is Dr. Amrit and I welcome you to part 2 of the fundus fluorescein angiography. In this video, we shall be studying about the abnormal patterns of fluorescein angiography seen in the fundus and diagnosis of various retinal conditions. The abnormal fluorescence can be divided into two types. Hyperfluorescence, that means when the intensity of fluorescence is less, or hyperfluorescence, that is when the intensity of fluorescence is more. Under the hyperfluorescence, again we can divide it into two parts. Number one is the blocked fluorescence and number two is the vascular filling defects. Example, the capillary non-perfusion areas. Coming to the hyperfluorescence is divided into four parts: the leakage, hyperfluorescence because of pooling, hyperfluorescence because of transmitted fluorescence, and hyperfluorescence because of staining. So let us look at them one at a time. There are basically two types of hyperfluorescence. As I told you, the first one is actually the blocked fluorescence because of blocking effect. And the second one is because of the filling defects. So either there is something which is blocking us from seeing the underlying fluorescence, or there is some filling problem into the vessels which is leading to hyperfluorescence. So first we'll talk about the blocked fluorescence. Blocked fluorescence is nothing but whenever there is blood or other opacities which are blocking the underlying choroidal fluorescence, it is called blocked fluorescence. This blockage of the retinal fluorescence can happen due to hemorrhages. It could be a pre-retinal hemorrhage, it could be a subretinal hemorrhage, it could even be a vitreous hemorrhage. Now, blockage of the choroidal fluorescence can also occur whenever there is a lesion like a nevus or whenever there's a lesion like a melanoma. Such lesions are also going to block the fluorescence and we are going to see actually a dark area in the fundus and surrounding which will be the normal fluorescence which is present. Now, there are two ways we can differentiate between the pre-retinal hemorrhage and the subretinal hemorrhage. A pre-retinal hemorrhage is actually present in front of the retina and therefore it is going to block us from seeing both the choroid and the retinal vasculature. However, the subretinal hemorrhage is present below the retina and therefore it is going to block only the choroidal fluorescence, whereas the retinal blood vessels are actually going to pass over the hemorrhage or over the blocked area. This picture over here is actually taken from a hypertensive patient who is actually developed CRVO. So you can see here a lot of flame-shaped hemorrhages are present, and corresponding to those flame-shaped hemorrhages, you can see these black areas. So there's a flame-shaped hemorrhage here and there's a black area here of blocked fluorescence. Okay. Similarly, there's a flame-shaped area here and there's a black-shaped structure. Now over here, if you trace this blood vessel, we can actually see the blood vessel passing through that black area. It means that this hemorrhage is actually a subretinal hemorrhage because the retinal vessel is not blocked by this hemorrhage. Now have a look at this image. Similarly, here also we can see this is a flame-shaped hemorrhage near the disc and we can see the blocked fluorescence over here, right? Yeah, next. Now, this is example of a pre-retinal hemorrhage. You can see, as I already told you in my video on vitreous hemorrhages, the pre-retinal hemorrhages are usually boat-shaped and we can see that this is a pre-retinal hemorrhage and we cannot see any retinal vessel. So there's a gap from here to here and we cannot see the background choroidal fluorescence that we see over here. So this is a pre-retinal hemorrhage which is actually blocking both the retina and the choroidal fluorescence. The next type of hyperfluorescence is seen in vascular filling defects. So vascular filling defects are nothing but they are capillary non-perfusion areas, which are also called CNP. These are the areas where we have decrease in the number of the capillaries, which is also termed as the capillary dropout. And such conditions in which we have capillary non-perfusion area are usually ischemic conditions of the retina. Example, the central retinal vein occlusion, branched retinal vein occlusion, and diabetic retinopathy. Now, as you can see over here, we can see a hyperfluorescent vessel. And similarly here, we can see a vessel. And we can see here the whitish background of the retina, which is basically because of a lot of capillaries which are present, which is called the capillary network. However, the structure over here is totally black that you can see, and this is a zone of capillary non-perfusion region, and this blackish area is called hypofluorescent area. Similarly, over here we can see that this is a foveolar vascular zone, and the foveolar vascular zone has actually expanded here because of the capillary dropout in this area. Similarly, you can see this entire blackish hypofluorescent area, which is because of the capillary dropout or the vascular filling defect. Now, this picture over here actually represents the two patients who have CRVO. In the first picture, we can see there are some dot plot hemorrhages. However, there are no capillary perfusion area. These hypofluorescent areas are nothing but hemorrhages, which are causing the blocked fluorescence. However, we do not see a capillary non-perfusion area. So this patient actually had the non-ischemic CRVO. Now, the second patient over here, however, has lots of cotton wool spots. So this indicates that the patient might be suffering from ischemic CRVO. And when you do an FFA, we actually saw that there are so many capillary non-perfusion area. Almost the entire fundus is looking blackish in color, indicating that there is ischemia. And this is actually ischemic CRVO. Next, let us talk about the hyperfluorescence. The hyperfluorescence is nothing but increased brightness on the fundus fluorescein angiography. And hyperfluorescence can actually occur because of four causes. The first cause is actually leakage. Second is pooling. Third is transmitted fluorescence. And fourth is staining. Now, let us see one of these at a time. First, let us talk about leakage. What is meant by leakage? Leakage is nothing but it is hyperfluorescence, okay? And that hyperfluorescence is actually progressively enlarging fluorescence. So this is the first point, that this hyperfluorescence will progressively enlarge, and it will enlarge in such a way that the margins will be ill-defined or fuzzy. Right? So what is happening over here is that the dye is actually coming out either of leaky incompetent blood vessels in the setting of usually neovascularization. Now, there are a lot of other causes also in which we have leakage of the dye, and these conditions are, number one, there can be vasculitis. Then sometimes there can be disc edema, and the capillaries which are present near the disc, those can become quite leaky and they will leak. So what is important with respect to leakage is that the hyperfluorescence of the leakage will actually increase in size and intensity both with the progression of the angiogram, and the margins will be ill-defined and fuzzy, as you can see over here. Now, this picture over here actually shows the neovascularization elsewhere in the disc, and you can see as the angiogram is progressing, the area of hyperfluorescent has not just increased in size, it has increased in intensity. The area of hyperfluorescent is extending beyond the original shape, the original boundary of the lesion, and it indicates that this is a neovascularization elsewhere. Similarly, you can see this picture of a patient who is suffering with Eales disease. You can see that the peripheral retina is totally ischemic. There is a capillary dropout in this area, which indicates, which is actually indicated by the hypofluorescent area on the FFA. And in response to that ischemia, what is happening is the neovascularization is taking place. And because of that neovascularization, you can see that we are seeing the hyperfluorescent area. And with the progression of the angiogram, this hyperfluorescent area is increasing in its intensity, almost glowing like a bulb. Yeah, that's what I mean to say by increasing in intensity. And moreover, it's also increasing in size. So it indicates that there is a leakage, and these are new vascularizations or the new vessels which are prone for leakage. Similarly, over here you can see the fan-shaped new vascularization which is seen, which is more common in case of sickle cell retinopathy. However, it can also occur in Eales disease, and you can see how these neovascularization are hyperfluorescent and they are increasing in the intensity, and then you can see this fuzzy margins and indicating that these neovascularization are actually leaking. Next, let us take an example of a classic CNVM. A classic CNVM is nothing but choroidal neovascular membrane, which is abnormal vessels which are coming from the choroid, and they are growing by growing through the RPE and growing in between the RPE and the neurosensory retina, as can be seen. You can see that in the initial phase, there is this lacy pattern of hyperfluorescence which is seen, and gradually with the progression of the angiogram, this lacy pattern is actually increasing in the size and also intensity, and later on in the later phases there is also some amount of staining and there is this fuzzy borders, and this is a classic picture of a classic CNVM. The next cause of hyperfluorescence is actually pooling of the dye. Okay, yeah, so what is meant by pooling? Pooling is nothing but it is hyperfluorescence in which the hyperfluorescence actually is going to progressively enlarge in such a way that it will fill the fluid cavity. Okay, and then once it has filled up that anatomical space, it will become fixed in size, right? So it does not keep on increasing in size and intensity just like the leakage. However, what happens in pooling is that it increases in intensity and size till the anatomical space is actually filled up, and once this anatomic space has been filled up, it is going to remain of that fixed size. Okay, so where is the dye going to fill? Usually the dye is going to fill up in a cavity like the subretinal space, okay, or it is going to fill up in a sub RPE space, example in case of a pigment epithelial detachment. Now there are two main examples that we can remember with respect to pooling. The number one is CSR, that is central serous chorioretinopathy, and serous detachments which occur in case of VKH, that is the Harada disease. Now this picture over here actually shows a patient who has CSR. So you can see in the initial thing we are seeing this dot like hyperfluorescent area which are then increasing in intensity, and finally one of the dot and leakage has started to grow upwards and filling up that subretinal space, and this is nothing but this is called a smokestack appearance. Okay, this is called a smokestack appearance. The reason it is called a smokestack appearance is that imagine there's a fire over here and the smoke is going to come out. The smoke cloud is going to move in the upward direction and it's going to look like this, right? So because of the similar appearance of the flow of the dye, this appearance is called smokestack appearance, which is very common in case of CSR. Now another pattern which is very common in CSR is that of an ink blot pattern, right? So this ink blot pattern is as if you drop a drop of ink on a paper or a filter paper, how it spreads. So similar way this ink blot pattern is seen in case of CSR, and the second picture over here is again showing the smokestack appearance. So both smokestack and ink blot pattern belong to CSR and they actually indicate the pooling of dye. Now this picture over here actually shows multiple serous detachments. So all these areas of pooling are nothing but dye which is getting accumulated in those pockets of serous detachment, which is seen in case of VKH, in which we have multiple exudative serous retinal detachments. Now the third type of hyperfluorescence is the transmitted fluorescence, and this transmitted fluorescence is also called the window defect. Now why is it called a window defect? It is called window defect because there will be a defect in the RPE, and as there's a defect in the RPE, we will be able to see through that defect of RPE the translumination or the transfluorescence of the choroid. Okay, so what do we know? That we have a choroid and on top of that we have the RPE. So if there's an opening in the RPE because of a defect, that opening is going to act as a window for us through which we are going to see the underlying choroidal fluorescence, right? So this is called transmitted fluorescence. One more thing about the transmitted fluorescence that we must remember is that it will increase in intensity along with the choroidal fluorescence. Now because it is a window to the choroid, all the lesions which are going to show transmitted fluorescence, they will get filled up with the choroidal phase even before the arteries start filling up. That is, in the early frames only we are going to see this fluorescence. Now the two examples of transmitted fluorescence is number one, the RP defects or atrophy, And number two, the geographical atrophy, which is also an RP atrophy seen in the case of ARMD. Now here, this picture over here shows the transmitted fluorescence, which is because of the RP atrophy seen in ARMD. Similarly, here is the geographical atrophy, and you can see the vessels underlying the choroid. That means the choroidal vessels we can see because of the RP atrophy. The fourth type of hyperfluorescence is actually staining. Staining is basically seen in scars. Okay, it is a late hyperfluorescence which occurs because of the accumulation of the fluorescein dye. Okay, the hyperfluorescence here will gradually get brighter and brighter as the time increases, and once it becomes brighter, it will never get more brighter, and the hyperfluorescence will not extend beyond the limit of the star. So what I mean to say is that the size of that staining will not increase, okay? And moreover, it is not like the intensity also will not be bright. So staining is mild staining. It is not very bright staining. The hyperfluorescence will not extend beyond the limits of scar, and it will not increase in the size, okay? So usually it is seen in case of scars, and it is seen in case of fibrosis. And one more thing where it is seen is, it is seen in case of drusens. Okay, so these are the three things which can actually stain in the late films. So here is a picture of patient who has acute posterior multifocal plicoid epithelopathy, and you can see these lesions over here which are because of the staining. Similarly, here these are actually hard and soft drusens, and you can see the drusens have actually taken up the stain in the later films. So staining is also a feature of drusens. So this was about the abnormal patterns, the very common ones on FFA. I hope this video was useful for you. If it was, kindly share the knowledge. Thank you and have a nice day.